Good morning to you. We're going to begin just one minute early. This is the day the Lord has made. It is great to have you all with us. We've got a couple of preview slides for the Facebook Zoom crowd. The first slide says that if you are on Facebook, what follows this service is not necessarily directed by us. It could go anywhere after we're done. And the second one is if you lose feed during Facebook or Zoom, we take the service, which is recorded, and put it on YouTube. And you can just go to our website and find the video from today. And also, there's a guest and a prayer reminder slide. Guest, please fill out a guest card. Put it in the offering plate in the narthex. If you're on Facebook or Zoom, go to our website and then hit contact us, and then I get that in my inbox. And then just want to remind you, if you're watching and you need prayer, you can call 304-485-5171. A few quick ministry updates. We're still staffing a Sunday school nursery, if you're willing to help. Gifts that you can give out are a bear, a children's storybook, or a candle. Those are available. If you want to know more about that, we will tell you. Coming up, there's a family event at North Bend Park on June 5th. Jonathan can tell you more about that. Thank you. We're still collecting two more Sundays for the Gusky Shelter. Men's ministry meets this Wednesday night, 7:15 in the parlor. Women's Bible study Monday at noon. There's a family game day coming up Saturday the 29th. This afternoon, very importantly, there is a piano and voice. The piano and voice students of Pamela McLean will present a spring recital in the sanctuary today at 3. It is going to be very special. And if you want kind of a preview, you can just listen to Lauren and Olivia, and you can come back at 3, and there's going to be more of that for the afternoon. So I know it'll be well worth your time here in our sanctuary at 3 p.m. A church member needs to move from one apartment in a complex to another room on another floor. I'm going to call the office and say, is anybody able to help me to do this? If you might be able to help with that, just fill the card out. By the way, those cards now in front of you can be used to give us an update, a praise, prayer concern, or if you can help this person move, just say, I can help, give us your name. What's that? It's going to be soon. She doesn't know exactly. It's going to be within the next week or two, so I'm just trying to find a person in advance that we can give them to. If you know someone going to college or graduate school, they can apply to our scholarship fund. And they need to do that by the end of May. I think that's... Oh, Wednesday night is our dinner, and then Awana Children's Ministry at 6 and Bible study at 6. So that's every week. And let us know if you're coming so we can prepare the right amount for dinner. Let us now prepare our hearts as David plays. Thank you. praise song is called Broken Vessels, and it came from the idea that in our passage where Paul talks about Israel was given all kinds of blessings, and yet they failed. They were left broken in the wilderness. And he was talking to the Corinthians, who likewise had been blessed, but they had failed many times. And so there's a lot of brokenness, but God takes broken things and does a miracle and can redeem us. And that's the theme of this song.
These pieces broken and scattered, in mercy gathered, mended and mourned, empty-handed, but not forsaken. I've been set free, I've been set free. Sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I am found. Was blind, but now I see. I can see you now. I can see the love. Down, raising up the broken to life. You take our failures, you take our weakness, you set your treasure in jars of clay. Take this heart, Lord, I'll be your vessel, the world to see your life in me. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound. Saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I am found. Was blind, but now I see. And I can see you now. I can see the love in you. Yourself down, raising up the broken to life. Amazing grace, how sweet thy sound that saves a wretch like me.
Father, we just give you praise today. We come not having it all together, but we come as we are. We come with our sin and our struggles and everything else, and we're grateful that you can take the mess that we are and do a miracle. You can take broken things and you use them. Help us to learn from those that have gone before. The history is replete with all kinds of important lessons. We're here to worship you and to gain insight into your character and to grow in our spiritual lives that we might be an impact, might have an impact on others. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning, church. Would you stand with me for our responsive reading? As our sermon topic is about learning from our past and remembering our history, there's no greater lesson from our history than remembering the faithfulness of the Lord. And so we read from Psalm 100 this morning. Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come before him with joyful songs.
Know that the Lord is God. It is He who made us, and we are His. We are His people and the sheep of His pasture.
Enter His gates with thanksgiving and His courts with praise. Give thanks to Him and praise His name.
For the Lord is good, and His love endures forever. His faithfulness continues through all generations.
If you would remain standing for our opening hymn, Like a River Glorious. Father, again, we thank you for this time where we gather. We thank you for drawing us here to this place and for your purposes in our lives and for your glory. Lord, I pray this morning that our hearts would truly be stayed and rest upon you, upon your love and your truth and your person. And Father, I pray that you would draw our hearts back to truth, back to what is most important, back to the focus on your kingdom, away from all the distractions of this world, away from all the things that would drag us down or that would steal us or steal your joy and your peace in our hearts. Father, I pray that that we would truly find rest in you. Be with us this morning as we worship. I pray your anointing over Pastor Kurt as he brings forth your word. May every word spoken from his lips be a reflection of your will and of what you desire us to hear. And now, Father, we pray the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the glory forever. Amen. All right, turn and greet someone nearby.
Hey, Smooch, how you doing?
Hey, how you doing?
Say hi to the kids.
Hey, how you doing, kids? How's it going?
I feel you. I feel like your voice is getting better.
Yeah, I've been working on it. You know, a little throat lozenge here and there. Yeah.
Well, good. That song that they just sang, Like a River Glorious, it just reminded me.
Hey, you know what? I was watching TV last night. I was actually watching with Sarah. We were on the couch. It was on Netflix.
Hey, wait.
Wait a minute.
You were watching TV with Sarah?
Yeah.
What's the deal with that?
What?
Anyway, I was going to tell you a story about when I went whitewater rafting and I fell out of the boat.
So this morning, a bird just hit the window. Pow! Man, it hit. I don't even think it flew away. It walked away.
Wait a minute. I was telling a story. I was whitewater rafting and we were surfing.
Did you know that the thing on the end of your shoe is called an aglet? Is that wild or what?
Smooch.
Aglet. Say it with me. Aglet.
Smooch. Hey.
What?
You know, that when somebody's trying to tell you a story, one of the things that's important to remember is that when they're telling you a story, they want you to listen to them. So when you listen to me, it shouldn't be like to think of another story to tell, especially one that involves the word aglet. You know, no story should involve the word aglet. But anyway,
I guess I shouldn't interrupt. Like, you know, when you're like, what, oh, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
No, exactly. When you're telling a story, then you know, if you were telling me a story, then I would listen to you. And then, you know, at the end of the story, I'd say, wow, that was really exciting, or I'm glad you survived, you know, I'm glad you didn't die, or something like that. But instead of, you know, thinking about, you know, when you were watching TV with Sarah, which, by the way, don't do that anymore, okay? If you want to watch, TV, do it by yourself, okay?
Yeah, but she smells better than you.
Well, that goes without saying, but even still. So remember, when someone's telling you a story, listen to them. And then just enjoy the story. And then if you want to tell a story after, you can, but let them finish, okay?
I got you. I apologize. Sorry about that.
That's okay. Let's pray. Your Father God, just thank you that you listen to us. When we pray, you don't interrupt us. You don't stop us. You don't tell your own story. You listen to us, and you let us empty our hearts to you. And then when we're ready to listen, you talk to us quietly, and we can hear your voice if we listen really, really carefully. We can hear you telling us that you love us and that you're going to guide us and help us to live the lives that you would have us to live. And help us to remember that with each other when we're telling stories, that we let each other talk and we listen and we let them finish their story. We thank you for your love and for the fact that you have always listened to us. In Jesus' name, amen.
The children can leave now, and the bird can leave and never come back. Yeah, you have allergies? Okay. I've got allergies, too. This Sunday and next Sunday, I wanted to take a brief moment to kind of look back and give thanks for different both groups and people that have shaped Emmanuel. I just want to mention that there are some very significant classes that some of them are no longer meeting, but if you look back in the history of our church, you know how significant that they were to our foundation. The base class met for many years. It was a singles class, and it was led by Jeannie Phillips and John Nicholson. And one of the things that the bass class did was you all built banners and decorated the church. And there were, I was told in the first service, there were battles between Jeannie Phillips and Ken Gilbert on artistic, on what was appropriate in the artistic realm. And I would love to have seen those on videotape. And Jeannie always won. She got the last word. And then there is the Excelsior class, which has this plaque that is two-stage there, but it has the names of members like Helen Buckley, Geraldine Lutz, Grace Smith, Thelma Siner, Virginia Canaltz, Mildred High School, Dorothy Satterfield, Phyllis Bennett are some of the last numbers on that plaque. But I was given just sort of a summary from a class member. I think this was written by Rose Wood. The Excelsior class was formed at Calvary Baptist. First teacher was Esther Roberts, and she taught from 1960 to 71, and then took a year off to get married. Eleanor Keck taught the class in 1972, and then Esther Roberts Escott returned in 73, taught three more years for a total of 25. Phyllis Bennett taught the class from 1977 to 94. Eileen Anderson taught from 94 to 99, and Mary Thomas taught from 99 to 2002, and then Phyllis Bennett came back to teach from 2002 to 2014. The Excelsior class held monthly meetings in members' homes. In the 1960s, they held various fundraisers that contributed to the church building fund. Throughout the years, they contributed to many church projects and served on various church committees. The memorial plaque was started in the 1980s by Mrs. Jerry Lutz and was kept up by Rose Wood. The class disbanded in 2014. The Harvester class, Meridor Keck, who is a significant member in the Harvester class, made a banner for the church, and that banner over there says, "To God be the glory," and that was based on a song in the hymnal, "To God be the glory," that we sang before our evening service, which we used to tape, and that the evening service was taped and put on the radio, which back in the day was quite, that was a pretty significant way to reach the community. I believe this was written by Doris Fiddler. For 66 years, the Harvester class has been an active part of Emmanuel. It was formed as a couples class and has always had a large enrollment at the present time. There are only 26 enrolled, but as late as 2006, we had 65 members. Following are people who have served as teachers: Keith Bobbitt, Jack Knight, Fred Umbel, Alta Watkins, Jack Poe, Gary Prater, Dale Lowther, and Earl Johnson. I remember the Harvester class had an annual fish fry. Bill and Evelyn Harden would return from Florida with a frozen fish, and then they would invite all the harvesters and staff, which would arrive, and we had a feast. It was wonderful. The class also enjoyed their monthly meetings where they ate well, and they'd always ask a staff person to dedicate their officers. And for years, the class reached out and supported the Colin Anderson Center in St. Mary's for the mentally challenged. They always found ways to support that group as one of their significant outreaches. And then Jan Ashwell wrote a summary for the Crusaders. So we've had the bass class, the Excelsior class, the Harvester class, and then Jan wrote Crusaders class, 1965 to 2020. Young couples with babies and toddlers, some singles and others who had not connected with a Sunday school class, came to the attention of Hal Parker and his wife Betty. Hal talked with Barb and Bill Ott about trying to get some folks together for a meeting at his house to discuss starting a new class. First meeting at the Parkers was 1965. In attendance were the Otts, the Ashwells, the Riggs, Jim and Ann Davis, and Betty Ball. Starting a new class, they discussed they would give it a try, and then in January of 66, they decided on the name Crusaders. The Crusaders have been an asset to our church by the giving of their time and finances. Early in their history, they had more time than finances, and so they got involved in a number of things. 40 active members in 1985, serving just on every board of the church as the base Excelsior. And Harvesters have also been serving in every area of the church. Our class started to have family retreats at Parchment Valley. where they would study Bible verses, hike, bonfires, hay rides, carving pumpkins. They also cooked and served 4-H dinners, filled Christmas stockings with the Salvation Army for many years, adopted a church family every Christmas, offered Red Cross blood drives, and started the Tuesday Fellowship Program for seniors back in 2001. Is that right? Hal Parker taught us faithfully till 1976 when he retired. Bob Butler took over teaching for many years. We had a period of time when Bob Butler, Gary Beal, Gary Prater, Lyndall Jones, and John Keck team taught our class. Bob retired, and Gary Beal taught us, and then myself, Bob Byers, and Ken Barton. We feel it's time to stop and reflect on what we have accomplished and help in any way to start a new class to start in place as they find their way, their name, to serve God and EBC going forward. We would like to name every person who has been a crusader, but the list is too long and would hate to leave anyone out. But you know who you are, how much you have served, gave of yourself, and God knows each and every one has blessed you accordingly. So I just wanted to offer a word of thanks to everyone who's been involved in these significant classes. If you look at our history, literally, if you look at our history, you will find the names of people from the base class, the Excelsior class, the Harvester class, and the Crusader class. They are interwoven into the life of our church, and we are here today and strong today because of those people who served and gave so faithfully. So I praise God for them, and we'll continue to find ways to honor them in the days to come. Next week, we will be looking at individuals. It's Memorial Day, and we have a long list of people that passed away over the last 2 years, and we're going to remember them in the service, and we're also going to have a memorial lunch. Afterwards. So you do need to let us know if you're staying after the service next week, because we have some people coming from out of town who are on our list, and we'll have a larger lunch than we normally have. I'm going to ask Davy Brooks if he would come now. He is going to read our scripture, Exodus 40, and he's going to be using the pulpit mic over here. Let's see how.
I'll be reading Exodus 40, 34 through 38. Then the cloud covered the tent of meeting, and the glory of the Lord filled the tabernacle. Moses could not enter the tent of the meeting because the cloud had settled on it. And the glory of the Lord filled the tabernacle. In all the travels of the Israelites, whenever the cloud lifted from above the tabernacle, they would set out. But if the cloud did not lift, they did not set out until the day it lifted. So the cloud of the Lord was over the tabernacle by day, and fire was in the cloud by night, in the sight of all the Israelites during all their travels.
Our passage today in 1 Corinthians 10, Paul relates how God worked closely with Israel to bring them out of Egypt and how he blessed them in many ways, and the lessons that we can learn from that. We have an opportunity now to give as we consider our offering. We have an offering slide just to remind those that are watching on Zoom or Facebook that you can send your checks in to the church. Those of you that have your offerings here, you're welcome to put it in the offering plate here or out in the narthex. Or you can go to our website, go to the header Give, and it'll guide you through a way to set up a gift, an electronic gift to the church. We are now blessed to have Lauren Modisette and Olivia Wilson sharing a duet for our offertory called None Other Land.
Father, you have so richly blessed us. Lord, you have blessed us more than we could have ever deserved or earned on our own. And Lord, we pray for your heart. We pray that you would give us your heart of generosity and your heart of compassion for others. Father, that we might be good stewards of those blessings and find ways to turn them outward and to bless others. Father, we continue to offer you everything we have and everything we are for your purposes and for your glory in Christ's name. Amen.
You'll notice on the prayer page there are a lot of praises, which is exciting. It means that people are getting out again. In fact, first service, I think we had three people that were out for the first time in a long time. If this is the first time you've been back in church for months or even a year, just raise your hand. I talked to some of you. Yes, I see those hands. I see those hands. It is good. It's really good to have you. Really good to have you back. I hope you feel surrounded by love, and part of our fellowship. I got a lot of praise pictures that relate to the fact that we're getting out and doing things. No particular order to them. I love dogs, and this is John and Kathy Alford's. Is it a Labrador? Yeah, and just a cute guy. Yeah, and then we have Samuel Schoenhut, who graduated from preschool this week. Very, very special day, and you can tell he's excited about it. Along with his allergies, he got a diploma this week. and then the next picture is him getting the diploma from his teacher, and he told me her name. I should be able to say it, but I don't remember. What is it?
Schumacher.
All right. Very good. And then this would be the recipe group decided to actually put their recipes into action, and they all made their favorite dish and came together on Thursday, and they all enjoyed a wonderful, wonderful food. I was supposed to be there, but ran an errand at the wrong time and came late, but I did get leftovers for the evening meal. There's Sarah and Jane showing some of their recipes, and I think there's one more. Yeah, there's Betsy showing off. That was a really good banana pudding dessert that we got some of that, too. That was really good. And then this would be the Zoom interest group that was doing games online. They got together and actually enjoyed sharing some games together. They'll continue to do that. This would be Dave Sims and Evan Fries, who were told by the church that there was a need. There was a family that needed a ramp in order for a person who was with medical conditions is not able to get into their home. So they showed up, the church paid for the supplies, and they supplied the labor. There's a second picture just of the ramp, and a third picture with the owner, Mr. Mitchell, surveying the job. It's really neat when we're able to step up and do something like that for people. I think they're friends of the Nicholsons, and that's how we found out about the need. This would be Delbert and Sue Casto. Delbert retired a few weeks ago, and I believe Sue retired this week. So they are they're on the loose, and just be careful. Watch both ways when you're on the road. I was also told that Derek McClung retires this Friday after 35 years at Comores. So that's a really special thing, and we'll get a picture of him. So have some significant retirements. And then there's the new church bus. We'll have Emmanuel put on the side of it. And related to that, we have drivers of the old van, which I'm assuming they're going to continue. They'll drive the van if we need it. But we need some people who are willing to drive the bus. No good if it just sits there. So if you think you might be interested in being on our list of drivers, please let us know. And we'll have an event where you can drive this around pylons. And we'll videotape it and put it on YouTube. I don't know. We're going to at least give you a feel for it. It's a really nice bus, and we're glad, we're blessed to have it. And then I think there's a series of pictures of the graduate dinner for Jacob Britton, Abigail Davis, and Becky Saucy. So it was a opportunity for the parents to bless their children after a nice meal that Jewel and company prepared. And then, as you saw, Jonathan was able to share some words to them as well. So there, I think there was not a dry eye in the place. There never is when we celebrate someone at a key crossroads. And there were words of blessing spoken over these students that are at a crossroads. And we're going to continue to follow them and pray for them and love them as they head into the world. That's part of our role and part of our job. So grateful for all who brought that together. I think that's all the pictures. Yeah. Last week we had a lunch for mission lunch and raised $1,000 for Madeline Flores in the Dominican Republic. And then a previous member of the church who tunes in felt that it was a good bet and gave another $1,000. So we raised $2,000 for Madeline Flores in the Dominican. The chess class met last Sunday night, and we are learning slowly. Lyndall Jones is thankful for all those who helped around with the lawn and helped put mulch down. A lot of other praises. I'll let you read them. Keep Kendall Kane in your prayers. Keep Jim Cox and Katie Cox in your prayers. Bernie Frazier, friend of Jane Graham, had four-way bypass surgery this morning. May still be in surgery right now in Canton. Jason George, she fights cancer. Patty Goldwyn, as she grieves the loss of her husband. Keep my Caden in your prayers. Dee Lalamont's coming home this week. Okay, are you ready for her? We're ready. Okay. Barb Malcolm, looking at heart valve options, and Pat Sayer will have heart valve surgery this week in Cleveland. And Christina Moneypenny, serious car wreck, and still recovering up at Ruby. Speaking of car wreck and recovery, we have Greg and Patricia Leach with us. Grateful to have you here. Grateful that you're able to be here after all that you've been through. Both have had some surgeries and anticipate some others, but we're thankful for the healing that's happened, and we'll pray for continued healing in your life. So any other praises or prayer concerns that we need to add? Yes. McLean family is praising God that Meredith passed her music therapy final exams, and now she's fully certified, and she's in right now in Atlanta, yeah, and practicing. That's great. All right, okay. Let's just sing one verse of a hymn I know a lot of you know. Father, I'm so thankful to look out over a good number of people, both at 8:30 and here in our second service. It's just good to look into the faces of people that we know and love, and for reasons of the pandemic and safety, have not felt really safe coming out until now. But it's good to feel like more of our family is together. We're also thankful, Father, that over the last year we figured out a way to put our service on Zoom and Facebook and YouTube, and it allows us to connect with people that were members here years ago and still feel a connection and a closeness to Emmanuel. Father, how blessed we are to have faithful people who attended the Crusader class, the Harvester class, the Excelsior class, the Base class. They were just foundational and continue to be in the life of our church. And we are so thankful. If we're able to see further, it's because we stand on the shoulders of those who have laid such a solid foundation for us. Help us to learn lessons from our history. We are great because we stay focused on the gospel, and we also seek to share grace in all we do. Father, may Jesus come into our lives and fill our hearts every day. May your Spirit energize us, illuminate Scripture, convict us of sin, and give us a longing for heaven, where we're headed. Father, the world is struggling in so many ways, and many times as we watch the news and we read the papers and catch the latest news, we feel a certain amount of despair. But we would ask that we would learn lessons from our own history and the history of our country, and that we would look to you. We know that you are faithful, you're the Lord of history, and one day, as it says in Revelation, the Lamb will take the scroll and open it up and bring to completion all history. And that Lamb is Jesus, our Lord. So when the world is falling apart, you are seated on your throne and things are working out according to your will. And we're going to trust that. In the meantime, Father, help us to learn lessons from the past that we may live more faithfully in the present and confidently go into the future. Thank you for this time, and bless our time together, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. If you're, I always forget to say this, and I'm just going to preface it. If you're listening on the radio, which I know some of you do, you can go to our website, which is www.ebcwv.com, and you can listen to this service that you're listening to. You can actually watch the video of it. You're welcome to do that. A friend of mine came to me years ago. I was in the midst of a conflict where there was some conversation and some emails going back and forth. Each of us kind of making the point that we felt we needed to make, and in the midst of a conflict where you might get emotional, you might tend to say more or send something that you regret. And I'll never forget, he kind of threw it off, kind of as a side comment, but he said, I always follow the 24-hour rule. He said, that's what I do. And I'm like, what's the 24-hour rule? He says, well, if I'm in the midst of a conflict with someone and I'm ready to tell them what I really think, he says, I pull back and I wait one day. I wait 24 hours. And then if I still feel the same way, I go ahead and either say it or send it. And he said, it saved me so many times. Just a random memory that came to mind of someone that I knew back in Clarksburg that I met with from time to time. And he was sharing from his life. He was sharing from his history, something that he'd learned. And I never forgot it. And all of you probably have lessons that family members and friends have just thrown off to you from things that they've learned the hard way. And we learn from the history of others. Like a parent or a grandparent who's talking to a child or a grandchild, they're going through a difficult time or they're at a crossroads, and you'll say, let me tell you a story about what happened to me or about a person that I know. Okay? And this all happened long ago, but it might just help you if you're trying to decide what to do. I've said those exact words to my children, and usually they would respond immediately, Dad, we don't need a sermon. And I'm like, it's not a sermon, it's my life. It's my heart. And here's something you need to hear. Ah, we don't hear it. We've heard it before. But sharing your life, sharing something from your history. This week, I go to the Colonial House once a month, and the ladies there love me. I'm a god at Colonial House. I was talking from this passage, and I looked out at these ladies that are 70s, 80s, 90s, and one of them's over 100. And I said, "You guys have amazing lives." One lady told me over lunch. She said, "I'm one of 16 children." I'm like, "Are you kidding me?" I said, "What was it like growing up with 16 siblings?" I mean, she probably didn't even know half of them. They were probably all gone. But I looked at these women and I said, you know, you have lived life and you have an amazing amount of wisdom to share with your children and your grandchildren. And the Bible says, respect those who are older because they have lived life. And if you're humble enough, you can learn from them and you can grow. That's a wise person, whereas a fool doesn't listen to advice. So I've been a pastor now for 36 years and I don't feel smart. And most of the time I don't feel very spiritual, but occasionally, God allows me to speak into the lives of someone else, something that I've learned. Sometimes I find myself with pastors that are in tough situations, and God's seen me through some tough situations in pastorates, and I just bring something from my history to share, and God uses that, and he'll use you in your life. So I just have one or two slides here. The first one is this one. In 1 Corinthians 10, Paul shares a history lesson to force reflection and to reveal something of God's character. And the lesson is this: pride born of privilege leads to pain. That'll pretty well summarize the whole message. Pride born of privilege leads to pain and death, but people who seek God alone find peace and new life. That's the essence of the message. And so Paul wrote 1 Corinthians about AD 55 from Ephesus when he heard that the church was going through a difficult time. Their problem was pride. They lived. Corinth was the New York of ancient Greece. It was the center of trade and culture and theater. It was also filled with 12 temples to Greek and Roman gods like Apollo and Aphrodite. And a lot of the worship of these gods involved temple prostitution, which meant you would go and you would go to a temple prostitute, and by being with that woman, you would connect with the god in the temple. And so sexual immorality was literally a part of their worship. And so the Corinthians were saved out of this into a Christian faith, which called for a different standard and new boundaries around sexuality. And they didn't take to it very well. In fact, the Corinthians are always bragging. They're bragging about their baptism and who baptized them. They're bragging about what group they're in and what leader they follow. They're bragging about their rights. They're always taking each other to court and suing them. They're bragging about their spiritual gifts. Some have a better spiritual gift than others, and they're even bragging about tolerating sexual sin in their own church. There was something going on. Paul knew about it, and he said, "And you're celebrating this?" He said, "Don't you think maybe you ought to go talk to them? And if they won't deal with it, there's more that you can do." So the Corinthians fully engaged their culture. They went to the pagan worship and they did everything else. And in the midst of all that, they said, "We're strong. We're so strong as Christians that we can engage the culture fully and it doesn't really affect us." And Paul says, "You're stupid because you say you're strong, but you're wrong. In fact, you have assimilated into the culture and you're acting more like a pagan Corinthian than a Christian Corinthian." And so Paul says, "You have been bought with a price, therefore glorify God with your body." So I would like to read for you from the Message. You can read from the NIV, but I want to begin 1 Corinthians 10, verses 1 through 5. And actually, I don't know how this will work, but there is a video from Prince of Egypt. There's actually a pre-slide that you can show. That's what you would have seen back in 1998 when it came out. And there's about 3.5 minutes of Moses taking the Israelites through the Red Sea. So I think we'll just see how this works. I'm gonna talk as this video plays. This might be a disaster, but hey, we're gonna try it. I'm gonna read now from the Message, 1 Corinthians 10, 1 through 5. "Remember our history, friends, and be warned. Our ancestors were led by the providential cloud and taken miraculously through the sea. They went through the waters in a baptism like ours, as Moses led them from enslaving death to salvation life. They all ate and drank identical food and drink, meals provided daily by God. They drank from the rock, God's fountain for them, that stayed with them wherever they were, and the rock was Christ. But just experiencing God's wonder and grace didn't seem to mean much. Most of them were defeated by temptation during the hard times in the desert, and God was not pleased with them." And so what you are watching is an animated movie that showed how the Egyptians followed the Israelites, and God sent a pillar of fire to literally create a barrier between the Egyptians, who had decided they didn't want them to leave. And there's Moses kind of realizing that that's one of the there's another miracle that they saw together. And it's all kind of beginning to sink in that all of this power is really with them. And he begins to feel this. And go ahead and turn the volume up for this. There's God speaks to him.
"This staff you shall do my wonders."
Okay, take the volume back down a little bit. I'll just kind of narrate as it just occurred to me that if you think about Israel and all the amazing things that happened to them and how they were blessed, God brought them out from Egypt, the plagues, and finally there was a Passover. They put blood on the door frames of their houses, and the angel passed over, and then he leads them out to this point where the sea actually parted. And after they go through, there's going to be a pillar of cloud by day and a pillar of fire by night that's going to guide them. And when they're hungry, they're going to strike a rock and get water. And then manna is going to fall from heaven, and quail. And God just literally is with them in such a powerful and overwhelming way. I just want you to imagine, what would it have been like to have lived this? What would it have been like to have been there? And I think this animated depiction is so amazing. And there's one picture that has always stayed with me that's coming in just a second. They're trying to take their carts over the bottom of the Red Sea, and it's not set up for like a road. But some animator had this idea of the torches that they would pass. And then I love this, lightning, and then you can see the sea life in the wall of water. Is that, whatever animated person thought of that was amazing. That's good. That's good. That's good on the video. My thought here is very simply, have you heard someone say, if God would just give me one miracle, I would follow him, I would trust him. God, just give me one miracle so that I know you're real. Well, who did God give miracles to? Like 100 miracles to? Israel. They lived this. They saw it. They saw the column of fire come down. They experienced the manna. They saw the water part. And still, even with all that, they became unfaithful, and they turned away. And so if you struggle with being faithful, you're not alone. By the way, one thing I learned this week, which to me is, there's a comic aspect to this. The rabbis taught that the rock that Moses hit, that the water came out of, that very rock followed them along the wilderness. And in fact, you're accompanied by the rock. So literally, the rabbi said that boulder would move along with them through the wilderness, which I think is kind of funny. You know, they'd be going along and they'd say, hey, didn't we see that rock like 2 miles ago? What's it doing back? And then Paul goes on to say, well, that rock actually is Christ. Jesus is the rock that gave water. He supplied the manna as they passed through the Red Sea. And in fact, Paul says, as they walked through that wall of water following Moses, it was kind of like their baptism into the promised land. And you've been baptized by Christ as you walked and follow him. And when Jesus walked on this earth, what did he say? I am the bread come down from heaven, and I am the living water. Eat of me, drink of me. I am the fulfillment of the ages, and if you truly trust me, I want you to go get baptized and go public with your faith. So Paul, in remembering Israel's history, shows the good things, but God was not pleased. And if you look at 1 Corinthians 10, verse 6, it says, the same thing could happen to us. We must be on our guard so that we never get caught up wanting our own way as they did. And we must not turn our religion into a circus as they did. First the people partied, then they threw a dance. We must not be sexually promiscuous. They paid the price for that, remember, with 23,000 deaths in one day. We must never try to get Christ to serve us instead of serving him. They tried it, and God launched an epidemic of poisonous snakes. We must be careful not to stir up discontent. Discontent destroyed them. So Paul remembers the good, and then he remembers the bad. Their privilege led to pride. They grumbled. They rebelled against God. They built a golden calf out of their jewelry as Moses is up on the mountain getting the Ten Commandments. And then they engaged in all kinds of sexual immorality, just like the nations around them. And then God brought judgment down upon them. And an angel brought judgment like we see an angel doing in Revelation. And it was an angel who announced the birth of Jesus in the Gospels, and it's an angel that Jesus said, I'll come with the angels in John 14 and receive you back to heaven. But angels also bring messages of judgment, and there are angels of death who bring God's judgment upon the world. Israel felt privileged and chosen and superior, and it led to pride. And it led to their downfall. They gave in to their fears. They lost faith in God. And almost all of them but two, died in the wilderness. Only Joshua and Caleb make their way into the promised land. The Corinthians felt privileged. They said, we are baptized in Jesus. We have amazing gifts. We are filled with the Spirit. We are better than other people. And then they too fell into sin that led from this pride and superiority that they had. And I love the fact that Paul is brutally honest. I love the fact that the Bible shows us the good and the bad and the highs and the lows. The Bible, to me, is authentic because the leaders in the Bible, you think that they had some say in what was going out. I would have, like, rewritten it. If I'm in it, I'm going to come across as someone who is faithful and strong. This is the history of Israel, and it shows Israel in the worst light. How is that possible? You read all the other ancient histories, and the king is infallible, and the people are perfect. The Bible is so unique in that it shows everything. And people read these horrible stories and say, why is that in the Bible? It's in the Bible because God shows the good and the bad so that we can learn from the bad behavior. This is what some people did, but you don't have to go there. We learn lessons from the bad things that have happened. So Paul says, look at history and you can learn what does it reveal about life and faith and sin and living well. If you look at 1 Corinthians 10 now, verse 11. And again, I'm reading from the Message. These are all warning markers, danger, in our history books, written down so that we don't repeat their mistakes. Our positions in the story are parallel. They're at the beginning, we at the end. We are just as capable of missing it as they were. So don't be naive and self-confident. You're not exempt. You could fall flat on your face as easily as anyone else. Forget about self-confidence. It's useless. Cultivate God confidence. So Paul says, we should learn from history. Okay? Israel became proud, and it led to pain and their downfall. The church in Corinth became proud, and it led to their downfall and to sin. And if we're honest, America has been blessed, and in some ways we've become proud as a people, and we have turned away from, I think, the God that and faith that has made us great. And I think we're seeing some of that ripple out into our culture now. So what can we learn from history, from our country, our church, our family and friends, and our faith journey? Just very briefly, what can we learn from history? If you think about our history, you look at someone like George Washington, who we find was a great leader, but flawed. But at the end of his life, he did something to set an example for us. Washington fought bravely in the Continental Army and led a small force against a larger British force. And if you look, we shouldn't have won those battles, but Washington was an amazing general. And he also presided over the Constitutional Convention. He was our first president and stepped down after two terms. He could have stayed in. He could have become a king. But he chose to say, I don't want this country centered around a person. I want a constitutional process to go forward, and he set the example. But George Washington owned slaves. They were willed to him from family members, and he owned them. But what did he do at the end of his life? In his will, George Washington released all of his slaves. He was a Christian, he was a man of God, and he was not comfortable with this whole thing. And so to set an example for all the other people and for all that would come after him, he released them. Now, did all of his friends say, oh, George Washington released his slaves, so we're going to release ours? No. And we've continued to struggle with that. In his farewell address, Washington said, America will remain great only if America trusts in God to guide them. And that's the legacy that he gave to us. What about Abraham Lincoln as we think about our country's history? He guided us through the biggest racial crisis and war that we've had. And in his Thanksgiving Proclamation of 1863, I just want to read this to you. This is Abraham Lincoln. In the midst of the Civil War, when thousands are dying every day, as we try to get a handle on this issue of race and slavery, what did Lincoln say? It is the duty of nations as well as men and women who owe their dependence upon the overruling power of God to confess their sins and transgressions in humble sorrow, yet with assured hope that genuine repentance will lead to mercy and pardon, and to recognize the sublime truth announced in Holy Scripture and proven by a history that those nations only are blessed whose God is the Lord. The awful calamity of the Civil War, which now desolates the land, may be but a punishment inflicted upon us for our presumptuous sins to the needful end of our national reformation as a whole people. So Lincoln felt that the war may have been God's judgment upon us for us to rethink who we are and what we live for. And then he said this, intoxicated with unbroken success, we have become too self-sufficient to feel the necessity of redeeming and preserving grace, too proud to pray to the God who made us. We have grown in numbers and wealth and power as no other nation has grown, but we have forgotten God. Abraham Lincoln, 1863, in the midst of the biggest racial crisis that we've ever known. And could that be true to us today as we face another reckoning on race? On July 4th, for the July 4th message, I'll get into some of the current things that are going on in terms of the 1619 Project and critical race theory that you hear a lot about. Suffice it to say that both the 1619 Project basically say that America began with slaves and has never gotten away from it. That is our enduring legacy, and we are an intrinsically racist country to this day. And critical race theory basically says that you were either a oppressor or oppressed, and if you're oppressor, you're white, and you oppress everyone else who's not white. And that's going out there, and I'll talk more about that. I do like what one senator said from South Carolina. He said, "Original sin is never the end of the story, not in our souls and not for our nation. The real story is always redemption." I like that. I do think that things like the 1619 Project and critical race theory, as I read more, I know there's more to this than what I knew and what I in my history class, but they point to the original sin and say, that's who you are. As an American, that's who you are. And I'm thinking, yes, but no. We also, as a nation, have been going through this process and wrestling and fighting battles and passing laws, and we have been reflecting and struggling together. Have we gotten to the promised land? No. But are we trying? Are we making some progress? Is there redemption? Is Washington a racist because he owned slaves? Or is he an amazing example because he freed them on his death? I don't know. I'm struggling with you people, but we are in a battle over what our history says about us. And it's good for us to reflect. And we look back at Israel's history, and they messed up over and over and over again, and yet God brought them through, and it was always a remnant, and he used them. Well, what about our church? Are there lessons we can learn from our church? I've always said it time and again that Emmanuel is a merger, and there is cooperation and DNA in our, there is cooperation and grace in our DNA. And even though we have struggled and had conflicts, there are great lessons that we can learn from our church and the classes that I've mentioned. What about your family history? As you listen to family members and as you listen to friends, do you learn things about yourself? When I was just home in Missouri, and I love when I get to sit around the table with my three sisters and my dad, and inevitably they bring up a story or they say something that happened in our family. I'm like, you're kidding. That was I there? Yeah, like, you know, and they're sharing my history with me and what I did, and I don't believe half of what they say because I don't come out very well on some of the stories. And then what about your own faith journey? Did your family go to church growing up? Was there a time when you had a spiritual conversion? Is there a time when you prayed? Is there a time when you got baptized? And where are you right now? One of the things I would love for more of you to do, someone this week gave me their faith story. And essentially what they've done, in a very short, concise way, they've gone through their life and said, this is what happened to me, and this is where God was in all that. And I've seen he's been faithful even though I've struggled. And I'd like for more of you to do this because we're going to sit down and we're actually going to videotape this, and then as people are willing, we may show it. I love how Paul ends this passage. He says, no temptation has taken you except what is common to man, but God is faithful and will not allow you to be tempted beyond what you can bear, but will with the temptation provide a way of escape so you can stand up under it. I love what he says, no temptation. He goes from the nation of Israel down to individual lives, and he said, every temptation that you're going through has happened to everybody. If you're going through a temptation, it's not unique to you. Everybody goes through this. The nation of Israel did it. The Corinthians had their problems, and we've got our issues, and you can learn from other people, which, by the way, is why we gather, why we have groups, is because when you're in a group with other people, someone will open up and say, you know, there was a time in my life when I made a really bad decision, and here's what it is, and God used it, and I'm here today. You know what? I failed, but grace is real. And then the word for way of escape literally is the image of an army surrounded with no hope, and all of a sudden they look up, and there's a mountain pass they had never seen, and they're able to escape through it. And so if you've ever felt surrounded and you felt there was no hope and you felt you couldn't make it, God promises to open a hidden pathway so that you can make it through. So in 1 Corinthians 10, Paul shares a history lesson to force reflection and reveal God's character. Pride born of privilege leads to pain and death, but people who seek God alone will find peace and life. This is Pentecost Sunday, when the Spirit fell on the church in Acts 2. The first Christians were just like us. They weren't Bible scholars or super spiritual. They were sinners who fell in love with Jesus. They were broken and made whole by the Lord. So I want to close with a video I stumbled across. It's called Broken Things by Matthew West. I've got a pre-slide there. Here's the chorus. Now I'm just a beggar in the presence of a king. I wish I could bring you so much more. But if it's true you use broken things, then here I am, Lord. I'm all yours. We'll watch about 2 minutes of this.
If grace was a kingdom, I stopped at the gate, thinking I don't deserve to pass through after all the mistakes that I've made. Oh, but I heard a whisper as heaven bent down. Said, child, don't you know that the first will be last and the last get a crown? It's always the ones with the scars that you use. Oh, it's the rebels and the prodigals. It's the humble and the weak. All the misfit heroes you chose. Tell me there's hope for sinners like me. And now
Father, thank you. As we look at history, we are thankful that Scripture is so brutally honest. It shows the good and the bad. We see Israel becoming prideful and superior, and we see it in the Pharisees who oppose Jesus and His grace at every turn. Father, we see it in the Corinthian church as they became prideful and felt superior, and then they began to act in ways that were counter to the gospel. And Father, if we're honest, we see it in our country right now, as we pridefully go forward, in some ways happy to be freed from the chains of religion. And yet, Father, as both Washington and Lincoln reminded us, we don't have a future without you. You are the solid foundation. You're the one that can teach us, redeem us, and bring forgiveness. Speak to us, continue to speak to us as individuals and to our church in the days to come. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand, and we will sing together two verses of God of the Ages.
Our pathway.
receive now the benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. Amen.